Hi everybody, this is Gijs again with another review and I hope you are doing well. This time it is a review on a pair of hiking boots. No better, two pair of hiking boots. The Loa Ledro GTX Mid for the male and for the female, the Lady Sasa GTX Mid. So if you are a couple and looking for a matching pair of hiking boots, watch this video. And of course, if you're not a couple but just looking for a new pair of hiking boots, watch the video too. Welcome to the review of the Loa Ledro GTX Mid and the Loa Sasa GTX Mid. Why am I doing, well, basically two shoes in one review? Well, that's simply because I started with the male version and later my wife got the Sasa as well. So it was very sensible to do a review on both shoes. Are both shoes the same? No, of course not, because the male is especially a male's fit and the women's one is of course a special female fit, but more on this later. Now let me start with the weight. I measured the Loa Ledro GTX Mid for the male at 567.3 grams on the left one and 560.8 grams for the right one, which makes together almost 1200 grams. And that's also the weight that Loa claims for a size 8. To be honest, this one is a 7.5, so that's why I have a little bit less weight on my feet. Now, for the female one, the Sasa, it's a little bit different. The left one, I weighted that one at 492.4 grams and the right one at 512.4 grams. And you notice already that there is a slight weight difference between the two of them, which is not too big, but it's there. Also, this is a size 5.5. Well, Loa claims a weight for a size 5, a pair, at a total of 900 grams. So there is a little bit of a difference between probably the same shoe and the amount of weight that we are having. But is it noticeable when walking? No, because when you walk through a muddy terrain like behind me, you've got so much mud in your shoes anyway, so that will put you into a lot of grams more anyway. So the weight is not a big deal. Now let me talk you through why the female one is different than the one for the male. The biggest difference between a male foot and a woman's foot is the heel part. If you look at the heel of a woman, it's way more narrower than most male heels. And that results in a shoe that should be built with a last that's also more narrower at the heel. And on the Sasa, that is of course the case. And if the heel part of the shoe fits the woman's heel more narrower, you get a better fit, so less friction, and therefore less chance on getting blisters when walking. Let's continue with the construction of both the boots. They are both boots in the category B. That's how we call it in the Netherlands and in Germany and in some other parts of in Europe as well. We call them B shoes, and B shoes are mainly for hiking, mountain hiking with not a too heavy backpack, and of course on paths that are not too complicated. They're not really mountaineering shoes, so it's just for regular hiking. And that means also if you walk the dog in the evening, these shoes are suitable for that as well. And this is all got to do with the sturdiness or the ruggedness of the shoes themselves, and also with the support that they give to your ankles and your feet. A category B or a hiking shoe should be also a little bit light, that's why the weight is not that high, and it should be sort of flexible. Now let me talk you onto the outside materials. A great part of the upper is made out of suede leather, but there is also a lot of synthetic material in here. Of course, that reduces the weight, but enhances the comfort as well. And especially if you see the tongue construction, this is where often a lot of synthetic fabrics are used, because you get all these layers on top of each other that fold. And in this way, you get a little bit more comfort. And to be honest, the male and the female version don't differ that much, except for, let's say, a three-dimensional print that is onto the suede here, which gives it a bit more of a feminine look. What you can also see, and that is one big difference, is that the, of course, the female version is a little bit lower if you take almost the same size, but it's also got one of these loops less. The male one has got this divider, in the middle. It pulls back onto the ankle, so you get this heel fixation very well in place. But on the shank itself, it's got two of these hooks. The women's version, it's got the same pulling to the back to secure the heel fixation, but it's got only one hook. Now, if we go to the protection of the shoe, that means the durability as well. The leather is fine, but also on the protection part, you can see that the male version has got some rubber on the toe cap, but the female version has got way more rubber, a longer rubber toe cap, which I personally, I would have loved to see the longer rubber protection on the male version as well. So I'm not really sure why they did this. If you look to the rear of both shoes, of course they're different in size, but you can see that the construction is almost the same because there is a very good protection on the rear as well. So if you're the person that kicks off the boots using one of your feet, this is really a well sturdy place to do it with. Of course it's not intended this way. And now that I've come to mention about the rear, you can see that there is a pulling tab on the male version, which is not available on the women's version. And that's probably got to do with the fact that it's got one hook less and that the shank is a little bit less high. So now I told you about the upper and I've told you a little about the materials, but I did not mention the outsole yet. And now let me take my wife's shoe, because this is a more dirty one. Mine's are pretty clean at the moment. As you can see, there is not a very yellow logo underneath this one, because this is a outsole made by Lowa itself. It is the Lowa Elica. And what we have noticed just by hiking in the Alps, but also in Sweden and here in the Netherlands, it is a very nice general multi-purpose outsole. It got loads of grip on wet and dry surfaces. But what we also especially like is the fact that it's got a sort of a hook underneath the heel part, so that if you descend, you really got some good grip with the heel part itself. And at the toe part, there are these little ridges. And these little ridges, they provide a lot of grip when walking up to slippery, muddy terrain. But also if you do some sort of a, well, not really rock climbing, but if you have to do some rock patches, this one is pretty okay for that work as well. Now, the good thing about the Lowa Elica outsole is that it is resoleable as well. So if you are done with a lot of hikes and the profile is totally gone, but you still like your shoes, you just bring them to Lowa or to the shoemaker and they will get a new outsole for you. I already mentioned a few times that this is a hiking shoe or a B category shoe. So it's suitable for not too heavy backpacks on mountain hikes. But how do I know this? Well, simply because every shoe that I test or review, I do a lot of touching with it, basically. What do I do? Well, first I look at the shape of the sole itself. And you can see this is a sort of a banana shape with a rounded heel. So if you put your foot down like this, it rolls very easy. The next thing that I do is to see the rigidity, and it's just a matter of twisting it in this way. And now you can see it's got its bending point nice under the forefoot, and that's where it should be. Some shoes have got it here totally wrong. You will get absolutely broken feet after a light walk. Now, the other thing is this is really stiff. So there is a plate underneath it that connects the rear of the shoe to the front of the shoe, and that is how it should be on a category B hiking shoe. If you've got a high altitude mountaineering shoe and you use crampons, then you won't be able to do this at all. The other thing that I always like to do is just twist it around its own axis, like this. And this also shows how, well, basically stiff or not stiff it is. And this is a nice mix between balance and comfort. The last thing you can always try is just look at the shank and the heel part itself. This should be a bit soft because that's comfortable, but here it should be more rigid because the heel fixation is very important. So in this shoe and also in the male version, this is fine. The Lowa Ledro and Sasa are both Gore-Tex lined shoes. And you can see it by the little logo that's sewn onto the shaft itself. The Gore-Tex, it is a membrane, so that means that if you have sweaty feet, the sweat can go out, but the rain, or if you walk through puddles of water or maybe small streams, the water doesn't get into the boot itself, which is of course very good. But bear in mind that with higher temperatures, of course, the Gore-Tex cannot release the amount of sweat that you're having. There needs to be quite a temperature difference between the inside and the outside of the shoe itself. I always measure the Gore-Tex height so that you know if you have to cross a stream how deep you can go to. With the size 5.5 female version, it is about 11 centimeters high. It's up to here somewhere. The gents, the size 7.5, it's a little bit higher than 12 centimeters, but that also differs, of course, by the size of the shoe that you are buying. So check this before you go out on the hike. Don't decide your buy on this, unless if you go to Scandinavia, you want to really have the high boots for going through really muddy, more like terrain. But in this case, it's about 11 and about 12 centimeters of wading height. I mentioned the small difference in the hooks on the shank itself, but for the rest, the laces and the loops are the same. The laces, they are quite thick and they feel nice to your hands when you tie your shoes, and they also don't have the tendency to loosen themselves. Some shoelaces have got this tendency, and that's really horrible because every time you're hiking you have to retie your shoes, or you have to make a very big bulky double knot on top of them, which I don't like either. The loops themselves, they are synthetic. I've noticed no difference in durability in my shoe life between synthetic lace loops or the metal ones. And what is a nice design feature is that on the shoe itself, these are just the nylon ones, but the other ones, they are covered also with a piece of suede, which I think looks pretty nice. One thing what is very important about the lace system itself is that on the tongue, and maybe I should show it on this one, it's a bit more visible, that there is this loop where you can cross the laces through. This prevents the tongue from sinking sideways to the left or to the right. Some shoes have got a sort of a hook here in the middle. This is just a loop, works the same, but you've also got shoes that don't have a fixation point here for the tongue, and then they always slide sideways, and that's just not comfortable. There's one other difference detail that I would like to talk about. The Ledro, the shaft and the tongue, they are filled with a nice foam padding. That's good for the comfort. And the same, of course, for the shaft and the tongue of the Sasa. But the collar itself, it's made out of a nylon mesh material, and it feels a little bit hard. When we take the female version, the collar, it is really a nice, very, very, very soft material. And I would not know why we as men would not would like to have this kind of material on the Ledro. On to the verdict. How do we rate the Loa Ledro GTX and the Loa Sasa GTX? Well, I should state that we have been walking on both shoes for about 4 months or so. And that started here in the Netherlands with just normal flat terrain, grass, muddy areas around where we live. And then the shoes performed very well. Then we went on a trip to Italy, to Valmaira. High mountains, steep terrain and lots of gravel. And then the outsole, it gives a lot of grip. We like the shoes in the Alps, but there's one thing that we want to make clear, and that is the fact that the shaft itself, it is a bit on the soft side. It doesn't give that much of support to your ankles. For us, we hike regularly, it's not a problem. But if you go into the Alps just for the first time, then you might want to have a little bit more support, especially if you are going with a, well, sort of a backpack that's a bit more heavy for head-to-head hikes, for example. Then from the Alps we went for 1 month into Sweden, and there we had, well, hilly terrain with a lot of bushes. One thing that we really noticed is that when you have high grass or bushes, that sometimes the tongue has got the tendency to collect grass behind it and it goes into your shoe. That's something we don't really get how this happens. It only happens when you're wearing shorts, of course, not when you're wearing normal pants, because then the pant go over the shoe itself. It's just something, it happens. It eats grass or some sort of funny way. But even in Sweden, we liked it a lot. My wife, she did 26 Ks on one day with this pair. And after that day, she was like, wow, this is really a nice, comfortable shoe to hike on. Her feet were not fatigued whatsoever. So that's a lot of good news. What I would like to see is that on the male version, the toe cap protection is as long as on the female one. So if they do a next year's model, please, please, please make it a bit longer. Then the price, let me please don't fall over. Okay, leave it like this. The price, both of the shoes, both the Lowas, they retail for €199.95. And we think this is a fair amount of money to pay for, well, this kind of quality shoes, especially because they are resoleable. And that makes the, well, the durability and the lifetime of both the shoes really, really long. And therefore we rate the Lowa Ledro GTX and the Lowa Sasa GTX at 9.1 points out of 10 total. And now the sun is coming. This is a nice ending. If this is the first time that you see a video of me and you tuned into my channel for the first time, then you might not know that I am a 100% independent reviewer. I'm not being paid by manufacturers to make my reviews. I don't have any affiliate deals and I don't have advertisements on my website. And I like to keep it this way. So if you value my way of independent reviewing, please support me. Subscribe to my YouTube channel, follow me on Instagram and like my Facebook page. And if there's anything you would like to ask or want to let me know, please leave a comment below. And of course, if the video was to your liking, give it a like. Enjoy the outdoors. Ciao, ciao.